call the meeting to order. Can I welcome members of the public, members of staff and elected members to this meeting of Cabinet this evening. There's just a few preliminary items we need to deal with before we get into the main business. So can I start with item one, members' code of conduct. Do any members of the Cabinet wish to declare any interests? No? Okay, so no interest. Item two is the minutes of the last meeting. Can I sign them as a true record? Agreed? Okay, thank you. Before we get into the main report, item four around the budget, there's a technical report that we need to deal with as item three, which is the council tax base for 2016-17. And I'm simply going to ask Cabinet to look at the recommendations on that report. This is just item three. And basically that is, I'll go through each recommendation, so the figure of 90,481.9 be approved by Cabinet and recommended to Council for Council tax base for 2016-17. Recommendation two, that the level of award in each local discount for 2016-17 be made as follows, and there's Wirral Women's and Children's Aid. And then we have a series of the empty property discounts as set out in the recommendations. And then thirdly, that the Council tax support scheme approved for use in this year, 15-16, is also approved as a scheme for next year, 16-17. So I'm simply going to move those recommendations and ask Cabinet, can we agree then? Okay, thank you. So that takes us on then to the main item this evening that I'm sure people have come for, which is the Council Budget 2016-17 and the medium term financial strategy. That's pages 19 to 50. In your agenda. What I'm going to do is suggest the following procedure for this. I've been asked and I've agreed to allow the two main reps for Unison and Unite to address the Cabinet. So that's Penny Cleary for Unison and Alan Small from Unite. I'm going to ask those two colleagues to speak. For up to 5 minutes, please, on this item. So we'll hear from Ali and Alan, and then I've got a few comments I'd like to make about this report, and then I'm going to ask for contributions, comments from other members of the Cabinet, and then we'll move to the recommendations. So that's the procedure around this item. So without further ado, can I ask Penny Cleary from Unison to
Thanks for having the opportunity to address Cabinet tonight on behalf of our members at Unison. Members for whom I am accountable to yourselves and accountable to the people of Wirral. Make no mistake, we find ourselves here once again due to the horrific cuts imposed on us by sector Conservative government. Conservative governments that have held down some streets inside the state and have opened more service provision in this country, most notably in the Northern Authority. Conservative government, as we know, will pay out the revenue support plan by 2020. But, and this is a big but, we are not a Conservative led authority, we have a Labour led administration. A Labour led administration that, once again, is attempting to attack the terms and conditions of the staff with the threat that if proposed not taken, will lead to loss between 1,800 jobs. Staff, who have shown more than their first year of cuts in 2010, staff that see headlines on payoffs, consultancy charges and agency fees that they didn't dream of. This, as we allow expertise to walk out the door, that could well be below us if paid directly. Staff that still await a senior management review, put on hold until our new chief executive was in touch with May a significant pay rise. Staff who have, in real terms, had a pay cut between 10 and 30% since 2010, without significant amount of 4 days unpaid leave, which in itself is about 2%. Mass insurance contributions to these staff will be going up by 15% on average from the year. This is those who are in the pension scheme. Paper tax is in place for some staff, and this initiative may. People will fall off the cliff under the Labour administration, with the real possibility of defaults and home losses. Any attack on enhancements will have a significant effect on staff who provide service after unsociable hours, but also have effect on taxes they need, like mortgages, loans, and other fines. These staff will also fall off the cliff. Services provided by those with essential car usage will grind to a halt as they will seek alternative travel arrangements to carry out these day-to-day duties. A collective agreement was signed 3 years ago that included not taking a 1% pay rise, a right staff will never get back. It also included 4 days unpaid leave, which if implemented again, will not only have a bottom-end detrimental effect on pay, but also on the detrimental staff. By not opposing unpaid leave, it's not just a pay rise, it's a fact given back what is rightfully there. This agreement was signed and reluctantly supported on the proviso for the same jobs, but we have lost, on a headcount basis, 40% of staff since 2010. During Prime Minister's question time yesterday, David Cameron stated that wages were rising 1.1 in the last 12 months, faster than inflation. That's what happened with all staff. Those staff who remain in the authority cannot afford any detrimental changes to their terms and conditions. They may reside on the road and will also face a 4% rise in council tax. They're like punch-drunk boxers, and basically, enough is enough. These proposed consultations also include the potential to lose 85 full-time equivalent posts alongside the attack on terms and conditions of staff. The majority of these come from peers of course to the loss of our peer navigation staff and in our libraries. As you're aware, the authority has three key themes in the 2020 plan for Will. The first being to protect the most vulnerable in our society. How does the community and the facilitate peers of course protect the most vulnerable in our society at a relatively small cost of 155,000 people saved in a year? People that use that service will be forced to seek alternative private arrangements. The continuity provision and dedication by the staff to these people will be lost, and the families, friends and carers will be faced with a very uncertain, difficult and challenging few months, on top of the issues they face on a day-to-day basis. Forcing more vulnerable, frail and ill members of the public to self-assess by reducing the amount of care that they take roles we have, once again to lie in the face of the key themes of 2020 plan. 40% of people in the world do not have access to a home PC or a laptop. Figures taken from the report that you published show. And I would envisage the majority of these people are those that will be asked to self-assess. It just does not make sense. Thus pushing 12 libraries into voluntary community-led ownership, increasing provision for those that actually need the service, and those that occupied areas for their others, with a simple increase in provision in our more affluent areas that have a strong voluntary group. Will our legislators be run by the community actually where or in the service as it comes back from the council and borough? A lot of assumptions have made in these proposals, like the fact that schools and landlords will make the community take the provision when they themselves are having to cut their cloth. Assumptions and savings targets that are over-optimistic, which as in previous years haven't been met and has led to more than 9 million from reserves being used to balance the books in this financial year. We will be asked to provide alternatives and dare I say, for example, a reduction in councillors from 66 to 44, which would save around £300,000 a year, and could well save the £3,000 a year. Nobody, least of all me, is burying their head in the sand about the challenging times we face. We do face horrendous cuts imposed by Conservative government. But today, that has made it even worse by the £2 million in the settlements which it believes we've added on. We are a Labour level authority in this board with 4 Labour MPs, all accountable to the constituents of Wirral. We as a union, along with our friends at Unite, are pleading with the cabinet to look after the vulnerable people in society and also look after the staff of Wirral by rejecting these proposals that affect these groups. Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Okay, can I ask Alan Small from Unite to address the panel, please?
Needs to stay. Also, skinned. That would have an impact on people who would, in some cases, would put their hand up to volunteer, would put them off on volunteering in the future. We believe that that would cause more compulsory illnesses in the future. I'd like to finish off by saying that this is a Labour-run council. We've always worked well with the Labour council. We understand that the Tory governments are relentless in attacking local authorities at this moment in time. We're determined to fight these cuts. We'll be standing shoulder to shoulder with the United to fight these cuts. Thank you very much.
Both Alan and Paddy for their contributions. I've certainly taken notes while they've been speaking in terms of the important points that both were made. If I could just say a few words before opening up to Cabinet. I think the first thing I just want to make clear tonight is we're not making any decisions tonight about budget savings for next year. That will come next March when we have our budget council. All that we are doing tonight is launching a consultation around budget options. And both myself and the rest of the cabinet have got an open mind about these options. And certainly what we want to do over the next six, 8 weeks is to listen to trade unions, members of staff, members of the public on what their views are on these options. And if there are any other ideas, proposals for either making alternative savings or generating additional income, then we're really keen to invite people to submit their views. So we've got an opportunity to reflect on what has been said tonight and more importantly to listen to people over the next 8 weeks before we have to finally make a decision at the council meeting on the 3rd of March of next year. But what I just wanted to say, you know, I think it is important just to put this on the record. Both Paddy and Alan are absolutely right. You know, we are facing really unprecedented financial challenges. We've got a Conservative government that clearly is out of touch with people in Wirral and Merseyside. I think Paddy mentioned the fact the first time in my memory, and I've been around the council for a long time, a decision has been made to completely get rid of the whole of the revenue support grant, which was the main block of money that we relied on in previous years to keep all our services going. For Wirral, that's £65 million going over the next 5 years. That is a massive, massive blow to the funds of this council. And as I say, the Tories have decided to get rid of that completely. The other thing that I think we need to recognise is they've come up with this proposal, again, the first time I've heard it, to basically pass the buck to local and council taxpayers to pay for elderly care with the adult social care precept. So basically what they're saying is, whereas in the past government have funded elderly care, they're now saying from now on it's down to local people to fund that service through again a 2% increase on the council tax, and I believe that is a total dereliction of the duty of government to fund what is an important service for Wirral. And as we know, we've got an ageing population here in Wirral, and the problem with using the council tax, we know we've got a very low council tax base, so we don't raise anywhere near as much money from a council tax increase as an authority in the south of England and in London. So again, it's another way that the Tories are hitting the North and Merseyside. We also know that they're getting rid of the council tax freeze grant. So that money that we've had in the last 2 years to freeze the council tax has gone. And we know that they're changing business rates. So again, whereas affluent areas in the south can raise a lot of money from business rates, we don't, and we think we'll lose about £6 million from the changes they're making to business rates. So all of this, all of those changes that the Tories are doing, I think are absolutely hammering local government in the north of So we need to, sadly, we need to make savings of 24 million next year and 126 million over the next 5 years. I think, Paddy, you mentioned it. We're just getting the information through today from the government about the detail of the financial settlement. And we think it's actually going to be worse than 24 million. We think it's going to be 26 million. So it's actually 2 million worse than we even thought it was going to be when we did the initial projections. So there's no question about it. We are totally under the cosh in terms of the way the government have decided to fund local government. And this pay-as-you-go great tax, as I'm calling it, for elderly care, I think is just outrageous. So we do face, I think this is definitely, I mean, I've been a councillor for many years, this is definitely by far the most difficult budget that I've ever had to deal with. So with all, having said all of those things, what I just wanted to say is, I think both myself and the cabinet are absolutely committed to working with the trade unions over the next 6 to 8 weeks and see if we can find a way to deal with this horrendous financial situation. You know, I don't want to be here, none of my cabinet and none of the Labour councils want to be here cutting services, but we've got to deal with a really, really terrible hand that we've been dealt by the government. The only other thing I would say, though, is we've got to set a legal budget. We will set a legal budget because the alternative is government will just send in commissioners and they'll do it for us. So the commitment for tonight is we genuinely want to go out to consultation, listen to what people are saying. We genuinely want to work with Paddy and Alan, the trade unions, to see what we can do to mitigate the impact of this. And as I say, if there are any other ideas to how we deal with this budget crisis, then we're absolutely keen to hear from that. But again, final point I want to make is, again, as a Labour administration, we will absolutely leave no stone unturned to make sure that we, as far as we can, protect those vital frontline services, vulnerable people, you know, and to make sure that we try and retain as many jobs as we can within this authority. You know, you have my commitment of that. So, as I say, recognising that we'll not make any final decisions tonight, we absolutely will spend the next six weeks, you know, talking to all of those key players, trade unions particularly, to try and navigate the way through what I think is an appalling situation that we find. But just to repeat, it's not one of our making, it's the Tory government, I think, and their agenda basically, their agenda is really to leave local governments, particularly in the north of England, to flounder whilst areas in the south prosper. And I think in terms of being totally unfair, that is a horrendous way to run the country and to run the budget. So I'm going to talk in about the recommendations in the report, but I just want to give other cabinet members an opportunity to make a contribution tonight. So, Anne, do you want to say something?
Thank you. We have worked really hard here over the festival, a lot of time and resources for our park. And, you know, to make sure that our council has led the way in the region and goes from strength to strength. And to stop off, you know, down the roads where we would abandon that overnight is just something that, well, personally, I'm not prepared for that. So, Chair, with that, I'm happy to second the proposal.
Thanks, Sarah. Okay, any other members of the cabinet wish to say anything? Okay, so I'm just gonna take this through the recommendations so that we know what we're agreeing. So I'd ask you to look at page 20 on the reports, item 4. So first of all, we're noting the forecast budget funding gap for 2016-17 is currently 24 billion. And the projected budget funding gap for the period 2016-21 is 126 million. Secondly, we're noting the impact of the budget reductions proposals for 2016-17 as summarised in section 3.34 and detailed in Appendix A. Three, we're authorising officers to complete the required consultation and engagement with resident partners and other stakeholders, that includes our trade union colleagues, on the budget proposals. Plans and budget decisions that we'll make in February next year are set out in Appendix B of the report. Fourthly, we're going to ask for an updated budget report and medium-term financial strategy on the cabinet meeting on the 22nd of February next year, and this will cover the updated financial projections because we've got more recent information in today and we will do it for the next few days, including the impact of the local government finance settlement expected, well, we've had it today, and the outcome of the engagement and the consultation which we're launching tonight. And then finally, we're waiving call-in in respect of these decisions as they're considered urgent, as any delay likely to be caused by the call-in process would seriously prejudice the council's and or public interest. It would adversely affect our ability of the council to meet the legal requirements, set a balanced budget for 2016-17, and just to reiterate Aaron's point, we will set a balanced budget for 2016-17. So those are the recommendations before us tonight, and you seconded those recommendations. So can I ask Cabinet to indicate all those in favour? Okay, those recommendations are carried unanimously. So we will now go into this period of consultation. I absolutely give a commitment that we'll continue talking to our trade union reps during that period and we'll come back at the end of February, hopefully with a set of recommendations that will address the issues that have been raised tonight. We'll do our best to do that, so we'll absolutely give that commitment. So that's the conclusion of this item. I'm just going to ask Cabinet to agree a 5-minute adjournment before we move on to the rest of the business. Is that agreed? Okay, thanks very much. Thank you.